On Zhongshan North Road in Taipei, next to the Taipei Fine Arts Museum, stands a butter yellow house like the one always appearing in a fairy tale. This mansion has experienced its ups and downs throughout its history. Back in the middle of the 19th century, when the customs office was set up in Danshui Port, Dadaocheng gradually became the commercial center of northern Taiwan. Since then, Taipei has been part of the international trading system.
可是大道城呢，到了光绪年间以后，它就发展的非常快。它主要是收集台北盆地，甚至包括大汉溪上游的一些茶叶，来这边制造。制作完了以后，它这边销售。The
Japanese colonial government rerouted the railway between Taipei and Keelung, meanwhile expanding the trading zone of Dadaocheng.
这个地方呢，就有很多的茶商致富。那其中呢，就是一个陈朝俊先生，他的父亲叫陈玉禄，他非常有眼光。当时呢，他就把他茶叶外销到爪哇，爪哇就是今天的印尼的地方。In
1900, 14-year-old Chen Chao Jun came to Dadaocheng with his father to take over Yongyu Tea Shop. 10 years later, his father passed away. Chen Chao Jun succeeded as the Secretary General of Taipei Tea Merchants Association.
那陈朝俊呢，他是一个非常善于经营的一个人才，他就专门负责做外销，外销，尤其我们这边大部分的外销到香港，然后转到欧美地区或者到日本地区。Chen
often traveled between Taipei, Gulangyu in Xiamen, and Kota Semarang in Java. Due to his business engagements, Chen needed a place to receive his guests and clients.
所以呢，他就要想建一个别墅。那这个别墅呢，一方面它可以招待外国人，因为在大道城一带那个传统房子，他总觉得好像不够风光。Sitting
on the banks of Keelung River and looking out to Taiwan Grand Shrine and Meiji Bridge. Yuanshan Mansion was completed in 1914. In that same year, Chen was elected as chair of Taipei Tea Merchants Association. This luxurious mansion by the river and the hill launched a golden era with its owner.
大概从1910年代到1920这段时间，是他的最辉煌的时期。
Back then, Yuanshan Mansion was in the outskirts of Taipei. The guests had to travel on a special route.
事实上呢，当时我们从大道城到圆山，它交通并不方便。我这边四周都是田地，我没有这个所谓的主要道路。它是怎么来的呢？它是从大道城坐船划了船，然后到这个地方，然后从这边上岸。 哦，这样上岸以后就是在这个我们今天后门的地方上来，哦，所以后门那边它有一个小港口，一个小码头。There
was a huge British-style garden surrounding the mansion. Part of Taipei Fine Arts Museum and Zhongshan North Road was included in that garden that enhanced the beauty of this unique building.
这个房子的盖法呢，很有意思，它是采用英国。 英国时的建筑，英国很多的传统建筑呢，都铎时期的时期，它这个建筑它这个样子。这个建筑我们把它叫做半木结构。所以半木呢，就是我们讲一楼的部分呢，你看都是砖头，都是砖头做的。那到二楼的时候啊，它的简青中样，都用木头做的，所以我们可以看到这个很多的骨架路明出来，好像树林一样的树枝一样的长出来。哦，这个是在都铎王朝的时候。
很风情这种建筑，像这种半砖半木构造，它在当年其实都被认定为是比较休闲式的啊，或者不是那么正式的那个休闲风味的这样一个房子。那我们在猜，其实也是因为陈朝俊先生他本身在做生意，他必须要跟政商名流往来，他可能也是想创造一个其实是很不一样的，让。 人们来这边觉得很新鲜，然后也会想来在这边跟他喝茶聊天啊等等，所以。 当年在这一带其实是一个非常休闲风味的，又在河边，那个时候也有码头。
As such a unique building appearing in Taiwan under Japanese rule, one would wonder who the architect was.
那日本建筑师到底是谁？其实也没有很明确的那个证据啊。有一个说法说是近藤十郎啊，但这个讲法其实也没有被很明确的那个验证过。
From the mansion-rich architectural style.One can see it applied various combinations and experiments.
其实日本就是在明治维新以后就大量引进西方的这种思维，包括整个建筑。那尤其是在台湾，因为台湾是他们新的一个殖民地，当年最流行的当然就是引进这种欧陆西方式的这种建筑物。所以我们可以看到这栋房子，它其实也是很典型的当年在流行啊，日本时代流行的一个仿欧的这种做法。所以我们从外面来看这栋房子的时候，一楼的砖造其实是比较稳重的，而且典型的这种西方的古典式样。我们可以看到有一些类似像文艺复兴或者是那种更古典的这种柱式等等。但是到了二楼木构造的时候，那它的变化就可以多很多，因为木头它是比较轻，然后比较好制作，然后比较容易去想一些特别的设计。在那个年代，二十世纪早期，在西方世界也渐渐开始流行起来的，像是 Art Deco 啊，就新装饰艺术，或者是 Art Nouveau 的这种风格，其实在里面也可以看到一些这种痕迹。所以它其实是一个混合的很多各种不同的形式，但是又让人家觉得非常那个漂亮的一栋房子。
Soon after the mansion was completed, the First World War erupted.During that turbulent time, Chen Chao-jun, the first owner, died of liver disease. What followed the end of the war was the Great Depression, which had a huge impact on tea exports. Encountering operational issues, the property was auctioned off in 1935. The Chens moved out. The fate of the mansion began its turbulent journey.Part of the outbuildings were torn down when public roads expanded. After the eruption of the Pacific War, the mansion was expropriated by the Japanese military police. A place which was used to entertain guests became a prison. Rumor has it that there was a water dungeon in the garden.
日本宪兵队使用过是事实，但是水牢这个事情一直都是在传说之中，连一些证据、图面、文件等等，其实也没有很具体的证据。
After the war in 1954, Huang Guoshu, then the deputy minister of the legislative yuan, acquired Yuanshan Mansion as his home. The outbuilding near the road was leased out to a Chinese craft shop. Since the mansion was initially designed as a place to entertain guests, it wasn't planned for living purposes.
一直到现在，我们在设计住宅的时候，都必须要留相当程度的储藏空间，因为一般人在居住的时候，他的储藏物件其实都相当的多。圆山别庄它其实并没有特殊所设计的储藏空间。
20 years later, Mr. Huang was involved in a bankruptcy of an insurance company. He and his family moved out of the mansion. In 1979, the Taipei City government took over the building management responsibility.And then handed it over to the streetlights office. It was used as a warehouse for several years.
这段时间空了很久，空了很久，所以他这个房子啊，最怕就不用，不用，因为门窗都关着，里面不通风，就很容易坏。
In 1983, the Taipei Fine Arts Museum was completed. The mansion next to the museum was in a dilapidated state.Therefore, the Taipei City Government and Taipei Fine Arts Museum began the restoration and management work. Finally, in 1990, it was opened to the public as an artists' club. There was a cafe on the first floor, and it was popular among the highly fashionable art lovers.
这个整个天花板呢，它四周呢都有这个通气孔。我们讲热的空气是往上走的。晚上走，如果那热空气它没办法宣泄的话，它会淤积在室内上面，那这个天花板就容易坏，所以它就可以 让它从这个四个洞呢，热空气就跑去到屋架，屋架在侧面呢，它有开口，它这个空气呢就可以对流，哦，使得这个房屋呢不至于太热，哦，也不会太潮湿。
Since Rinshan Mansion was built, it has gone through many years of usage and renovation. But the fireplace, the beautiful floor tiles, and the molded plasterwork ceiling were well kept and remained intact.
那我们可以看到说，这个壁炉其实在当年只要是比较稍微有点规模，我们称之为所谓豪宅的房子，几乎都有这样的一个壁炉。台湾理论上不太需要壁炉。除非以前在比较阳明山或者什么冬天比较冷的地方，但在那个年代，其实壁炉还是一个很重要的这种交际上很重要的象征。所以那个壁炉很小，那但是又很精致。那另外就是我们可以注意到室内其实有一些地方有花砖，包括一楼的壁炉的旁边，好，那二楼那个有水的像那个浴室等等，它某个程度上也显现了那个年代的那种很精致或者是很奢华的那种风格。
The objects and the space preserved in this building are the extension of aesthetic education and exhibition zoning.
我觉得不同年代其实观念是很不一样。好，那北美馆它其实在1970年代末期就开始规划，然后1980年代初期开放，就那个开放使用。我们回过头来看北美馆，它非常现代主义的、非常干净的这个形式，放在圆山别庄旁边，其实看起来其实也没有不协调。一直到现在，整个看起来它其实也是很重要的历史的两个共存的一部分。
Having been open to the public for a while, this almost 100-year-old building needed to be thoroughly maintained and renovated. In 1998, the Taipei City Government listed Rinshan Mansion as a historical site.And carried out an elaborate research and repair work, aiming to restore and fully utilize the building.
古迹很重要，哦，古迹需要有保存，哦，要经常的这个不断的维修。但是呢，它所耗的费用非常大。
Having restored the mansion, the Taipei City government commissioned a private company to run it under the Old House Culture Movement, which made the company responsible for the maintenance work. A model of historical site collaboration was gradually established.
未来圆山别庄将会定位成一座融合新跟旧的一个展演空间。那会选做艺文空间，很大的一个原因是因为过去这边曾经是艺术家联谊中心。其实他在这之后也经历了很多的经营者，那其中陈国慈女士当初是把圆山别庄蜕变成一座像是博物馆，然后改名叫做台北故事馆。那其实故事这个名字也蛮有趣的，我觉得它意味的是说，其实故事一直在不断的演变，然后到现在也是没有结束，然后等待后面的经营团队来继续去用不同的方式呈现它。那由我们经营的圆山别庄，我们将着重在更多不同领域的艺术创作，比如说像是现在可能有音乐创作，然后影音的创作，更新一代的比如说 YouTuber 或是插画家，这个空间会非常欢迎像是这种形态的创意工作者来进驻，来做发表或者是做一些交流。那其实跟过去艺术家联谊中心的性质会有点接近。那餐饮跟附属设施，我们的规划是在于说怎么去把咖啡跟艺术串联在一起，这是我们接下来要做的事情。所以我们希望能参访的客人都是能够品味新时代的饮食艺术，然后也可以丰富圆山别庄跟北美馆园区的整个参观体验。我们自己是期许能够做得更好、更精致、更现代的思维去呈现。那也希望这个房子能够在我们经营下保存得更好，然后也可以让更多的人、更多的民众知道它。
当我们真正能够进入到这个空间，我们完全能够想象古人们、我们的先祖们在这边生活的一些情景的时候的那种连接感，我觉得是其他的那个老东西所完全没有办法所比拟跟达到的。所以这也是我们觉得那个修古迹跟古迹做再利用最重要的一个目的。
Going back to the 20th century, when a Dadao Cheng tea merchant Chen Zhaojun built the Yuanshan Mansion, We have seen the challenges that were overcome through its restoration and now its full glory. Its future will continue to closely relate the lives and the histories of the people in Taipei as more fabulous stories evolve for the years to come.